Hey, how's it going? This is a video I've been thinking about making for a long time because I think there's a lot of personal debate over which software is the best. And I think it more or less comes down to your personal preferences, how you're going to use them, and then how they work as tools for whatever you want to create visually. A lot of times people will think of TouchDesigner as being something exclusive to an installation, but people use that for performances all the time, or they think that Resolume is the only VJ software that seems to do it all, and it's also cross-platform, which is true in many ways, but there are times whenever you might not want to use Resolume based on what you're trying to do. And the same goes for MadMapper and VDMX and other softwares that are out there. Some of the softwares that I'm not going to talk about are Millumin, QLab, and Isadora. And the main reason I'm not going to cover them is I want to keep this more exclusive to people who are performing with visuals, live VJing. This also goes out to people who are thinking about VJing for the first time. Simple answer, do it. So to start it off, I'm just going to start off with Resolume. I have Resolume Arena. I've had it since version 5, I believe. And I honestly rarely use it. Most of the time I'll use Resolume whenever I'm building something for an artist that is going on tour and using Resolume. But the reasons why I don't use it is primarily for my own preference. At this point, I've been a longtime VDMX user, and I am also known as somebody who helps people with customer support and questions for VidVox. So even though this might sound like a sales pitch for VDMX, it's really not, because this is a preference and you might find that you don't like the VDMX interface. The great part about Resolume is that when you open up the software, the interface looks the same. Whether you're on Mac, PC, if you're traveling around the world and you just want to do a pop-up in a different venue, Resolume gives you that ability to just sort of jump into an event site and go plug and play, which is fantastic. At the same time, that's also one of the downsides of Resolume, is that it isn't as customizable as you might want, like TouchDesigner, if you wanted to do something a little bit more immersive, or you wanted to build out a show that integrates with a lot of different technologies that are either emerging or you are developing yourself. And another huge pro for Resolume, where it honestly wins across the board, is that it's on Windows. VDMX is Mac only. You have MadMapper, which is available for Mac and PC and TouchDesigner. But if you are a PC user and you are trying to get the most out of your gaming laptop or something with an NVIDIA GPU, Resolume is sort of the only game in town when it comes to Windows VJing. That being said, Resolume boasts the most performance whenever you use their own proprietary codec called DXV. And why do we care about this? Well, the trade-off is that DXV, while it works great in Resolume, it doesn't necessarily work great in other applications. Whereas a codec like HAP is actually open source and boasts a lot of the same performance benefits in all the applications that I'm talking about. So why would we care about this? Well, for one, if you are working on a complex project and you're sending it somewhere else in the world, or you're doing installation maybe in a museum or something like that, or you're just making content and you're making specifically DXV related files, it's a little bit harder to convert and to share with people that aren't aware of that setup. The biggest trade-off is actually whenever you get into sort of the media server category, because some of the media server softwares, Disguise, I believe, accepts the DXV codec and a few other ones, but Datatron for Watchout doesn't. And what you'll find is these media servers are usually preferential to the different venues or to the different countries that you're going in. So if you're building out something a little bit more complex and you want to be able to ship it, using the HAP video codec is going to be a little bit better. And Resolume does accept HAP, but there are people that kind of complain about it. And at the same time, let's talk about Notch. So people will also say for much better quality, you want to use the Notch LC codec. The problem with the Notch LC codec, which I don't use for most of my performances, is that Notch LC works great on machines that are Windows. And there's conversations going on in the forums about slow conversion times to Notch LC on Mac, and the SDK isn't open. So if you're talking about trying to get away from proprietary codecs like DXV, Notch LC, while it provides some quality benefits, also is getting back more into that proprietary camp. So I do love HAP. And if you're curious, HAP-R has been released, which also provides significant performance benefits and quality benefits. It's just, it hasn't been fully integrated by every media server at this point, but it probably will be by the end of the year at that. So I know this is a long rant about codecs, but the other thing is, if you don't have your codecs figured out, you're going to get into some system bottleneck, and it's mostly going to be around the bandwidth of playing back these codecs. And lastly, if you're really trying to make a setup where you're only playing back a few video clips and you want it so that you can send these files pretty much anywhere, you want to look into making H.264 files with a keyframe or each frame. So if you're using FFmpeg to do your conversions, which some of you might be doing, even if you're unaware of, a lot of these batch encoders use FFmpeg. FFmpeg refers to it as a group of pictures. And if you set your group of pictures as one, it means that every single frame in that video, let's say it's 30 frames per second or 60 frames per second, is going to be an image on every single frame to give you the highest quality, but also reduce the load on your CPU. And why is that important? Because we're dealing with computers with limited resources. So if we really optimize the codecs, you're gonna get much better performance out of any of these softwares, and also on these media servers that require it. So when it comes to, you know, favorite ways of handling things, if it's not that many video files, I love H.264 with a keyframe for every frame. After that, I'd go with HAP. And then after that, if you really need quality or you're specializing in just Resolume or even Notch, LC, and DXV codec ranges. And if there's more out there, feel free to comment below. There are some that have risen and fallen over the years, but these are the ones that you see most common. And if you don't know about this, I can put links in the description below, but I don't want to spend too much time nerding out on video codecs, even though it's really important. So take note of that. So jumping back into Resolume, if we go to our advanced output settings, we can set up things that are familiar in projection mapping. And this is honestly one of the places where VDMX is lacking. VDMX. So VDMX, for instance, does have advanced output options where you can, let's just do this. Let's just make a new screen. I'll turn that off for now. You can make sort of adjustments of horizontal flip, vertical flip. You can go into the advanced side and you can start to manipulate these things and choose from different sources. It's great. It's extremely customizable, but it doesn't necessarily have warping capabilities you'd expect in projection mapping. So if I'm running MadMapper, for example, I can quickly come in here and also adjust. This is my input on the left side, and on the right side is my output. So I'm just gonna focus on the output for right now. I can adjust this to fit to whatever canvas that I wanna put on, which is similar to Resolume in many ways. But the added benefit of MadMapper, especially if you're using VDMX, is that MadMapper, which is currently on sale, MadMapper, if you're gonna buy it, is 479 euros on a regular basis, whereas Resolume is 799 euros. And VDMX is as low as 199. And when all of these go on sale for Black Friday, Cyber Monday, you get them for a lot less. But at this point, you can buy VDMX and MadMapper, which are perpetual licenses to use for VJing and projection mapping, and actually save some money. And the trade-off there is that Resolume tends to offer upgrade licensing yearly, which means that if you really want to keep up with the latest version of Resolume, you're gonna have to pay them money every year. Luckily, they haven't gone to a software service model like Adobe, but with VDMX, VDMX 5, the first license of VDMX 5 I purchased was in 2009, and there was never an upgrade fee until they released VDMX 6, which is kind of mind-blowing because that was 15 years later. So to spend $100 or something like that on a software that you really love and use it for over a decade is kind of unheard of. So that being said, I kind of want to get right into VDMX and why you might prefer to use this over Resolume or MadMapper. The real pros and cons of VDMX is the cons are obviously it's Mac only, but at the same time, it's also optimized for Mac computers. So VDMX kind of fits into this place where Resolume is, you know, out of the box, you can just run it. It works the way that it does. TouchDesigner is extremely customizable, but also because you're getting into this node-based environment, it's can be too difficult to just jump right into. So VDMX works somewhere in between Resolume and TouchDesigner in that it is more modular based, but because it's using plugins, you don't have to worry about nodes and how to link things to get them to work. It will just work whenever you start playing with it. The most important reason why I recommend VDMX to anybody who at least has a Mac computer and is interested in this is the demo version of VDMX is fully functional. That's right, you can just download VDMX, install it, and perform. There's no time limits, there's no watermark, there's no resolution limits. You can just use the software as is and start making money with it, which is something that you probably want to do first before you start investing in lots of software. And why would VDMX do that? Well, because they know that the learning curve can be an issue, but they also don't want the financial barrier to be an issue to you getting into making live performances. And the easiest way to get up and running with VDMX is you download and install it, And then you just go up to templates and you just choose one of the templates. So if I just choose simple mixer, now I have a two-way video mixer where I can just drag and drop clips into the left and right. So even though Resolume is out of the box, same setup, you could also do the same thing with VDMX if you just use templates. Or once again, you can travel around with your project files, your video files and your VDMX project, and just open them up on a new computer without installing a license each time. The added benefit there is Resolume has a dongle, but that's also another USB port that you have to take up on a computer. And then if you lose the dongle, you also lose your license, which can be pretty sad. So getting started in VDMX, there's lots of tutorials on it, and I don't need to give people a big dive in it. But the added benefit is that you can just come in here and you can add plugins to achieve the thing that you're trying to do, or you can stitch different plugins together with different data sources. Let's just say MIDI, OSC, hand tracking and people tracking, and just start making content the way that you want. And VidVox itself helped create the HAP codecs, which I mentioned before. And then there's ISF Shaders, which is like an open spec shader format. So you can actually just go to this online portal, download a number of different effects, and then apply them. And if you're trying to, you know, get outside of VDMX, or you feel VDMX doesn't do enough, you can just get into using VDMX 6 Plus, which uses Vuo compositions and TouchDesigner compositions to do more in VDMX that you couldn't do before. The trade-off there is that you need a TouchDesigner paid license, whether it's educational or commercial, which does add another cost. But if we're going down that road with TouchDesigner, we're gonna talk more about custom experiences that you wanna develop and you need to build it from scratch. With that being said, my favorite advice to give to people with VDMX is just jump in and start playing with it. And it's actually at no cost to you to use a demo version that's fully functional, so you can just start performing with it. And I say that because at one point in 2009, I used VDMX for probably 8 months at gigs where I got paid. And then eventually I purchased my license on a Black Friday, Cyber Monday sale, and I made way more than I spent on VDMX. So at some point, I think you're just gonna wanna get to the point where you wanna save projects, especially if you become a more consistent user. But the actual cost of VDMX is the lowest out of all these softwares. And what it offers from the ground up is a way to just get started with performing. And once again, the biggest downsides are Windows. It's not available on Windows. So if you only have a Windows computer and that's part of your budget and that's your limitation, you really are looking at this TouchDesigner, MadMapper, Resolume area. But if you do have a Mac computer or you got one for school, VDMX is probably the easiest one to try out of the box because you don't have to pay for it and you can start using it right away. And another quick tip is if you go to the help and you click on open demo project, it's going to load a project that's pretty similar to that two-way mixer. And it's just going to give you things that you can play with. And you can actually see these are ISF shaders. So see how it says right here, ISF interface. This is giving you some functionality to play around with generated visuals in real time. If you go to the VidVox website, you click on tutorials, you're gonna find a lot of different tutorials. But one of the things I want you to look at, if you do wanna sort of go beyond VDMX's default capabilities, is take a look at using Vuo, which will let you build out custom effects in another node-based setup. This is an option. This is similar to TouchDesigner. And this is why Resolume has Resolume Wire, so that you can start to build out things in more of a node-based setup. So there's definitely pros and cons to that. I just think, personally for me, if I'm gonna do something node-based, I'm probably gonna work in TouchDesigner. I'm also more comfortable in it, and I know that sort of the sky's the limit and the community's there to really help with pushing my development or getting my project working. And the added benefit is because I said I use VDMX, I can export the TouchDesigner project I'm working on in most instances as a .tox file, and then I can just load them into VDMX and run them inside that software while I'm switching between other video clips and assets. Another place where VDMX is lacking is there's no undo function. Hopefully one day they have an undo feature, but also hopefully one day VDMX is window-based, and right now it's not, and that's okay, because it works and it's a great tool for people to use. So now I really want to get into TouchDesigner. TouchDesigner is also node-based, which is awesome because you can come in here and you can customize things however you want. In fact, some of the coolest integrated projects I've ever seen, this is actually Monocolor Marion, who's from Vienna, are done in TouchDesigner. And nowadays, a lot of this crossover between TouchDesigner, MadMapper, Resolume, VDMX, all these things are great because you can use Syphon or Spout to share what's on the GPU, basically what's rendering out visually, with another application and use it in another application. As long as your computer can handle it, you can use all these different things to really do a custom setup however you want. And it is up to preference at this point. Some things are going to be easier to learn. So if I talk about MadMapper specifically, MadMapper is great for projection mapping, doing things in more scene-based queue. There's now a new timeline in MadMapper 6, but also they have additional plugins or modules that you can use. You can control DMX lights. And one of the biggest marquee features of MadMapper now is actually your laser control. So make a laser, which if you want to get this type of functionality on another Windows or Mac computer, for Windows, you have Pangolin to do your laser light shows. Or now there's Liberation, which is great. This is an alternative to Pangolin. So I don't want to get too much into the laser camp of things, but MadMapper, for its price point and what it offers across the spectrum of visual performances, is so cool. And you can integrate that with Resolume, you can integrate that with VDMX or even TouchDesigner, and just share things via Syphon. Here's all the different applications that you can use with Syphon. And Spout is the Windows equivalent of Syphon. It does pretty much the same thing that Syphon does on a Mac computer, Spout does on a Windows computer. So keep those two in mind. Once again, if you're playing around with lasers, feel free to try out Liberation, another great software. And this is a great alternative to Pangolin, which is known to be very expensive because it requires proprietary hardware to work with their software, which also I've taken Pangolin training workshops. Is one of the wildest customizable softwares I've ever seen in my life, but it is Windows only. So if you're really curious about which software to pick next, you don't even have to listen to me. You can just jump onto the Instagram channels, if you use Instagram, each of these companies. So this is TouchDesigner. Let's go here to Resolume. Let's do @VidVox. So here's examples of people using VDMX for projection mapping. They're probably also using it along with MadMapper, which is really common. Immersive installations. This is an example of someone using VDMX, Vuo, TouchDesigner. TouchDesigner is amazing for performances and installations and things that you might need to use NVIDIA GPUs for. And out of all these softwares, TouchDesigner probably has the greatest learning curve. So if you are trying to do a show 2 or 3 days from now, TouchDesigner might be the thing that you want to take a little bit more time to develop your skills on versus jumping into. But if you really want to do something that is one of a kind, unique, use data points, use depth cameras, special trackers, custom things that you design, TouchDesigner is the thing that's going to allow you to integrate all those and has a huge community behind it. So in the final summation, I hope that you found this useful for figuring out which software you would like to use or try or learn. And at the same time, all of these softwares tend to go on sale around Black Friday, Cyber Monday, which is sort of why I'm pushing out this video now. Because if you're interested in purchasing a license, this is a good time to do it. And MadMapper is also having a sale, and they just created MadMapper 6. And the reason I know about that is because if we go to the new certified training network, there I am. MadMapper has a great team behind it. So I can't stress enough that I really do look forward to seeing what they come up with next. Each of these tools has a place. And now with computers being as powerful as they are, you can integrate multiple ones on the same show. So not to make this video about me, but here's an example of a project I worked on where I was using MadMapper, VDMX, and QLab all at the same time. And it works great. And it also gives me a level of redundancy that if something were to happen with the live cameras in VDMX, that I could also just switch over to some sort of pre-recorded footage either in MadMapper. And QLab offers projection mapping, but it's a different type of show. We're talking about shows that you perform live and there's a lot of tweaking in real time versus shows that are essentially just designed to be executed, you know, with Go commands as simply as possible. Remove any possibility for somebody to screw it up. Whereas most of the world that I live in, it's my screwing it up intentionally in the moment or going with the flow is what people are actually looking for. Use the software, learn the software. You're gonna find that all of them can do a lot and they can't do everything, but that's okay because you can integrate them on the back end with Syphon or Spout or OSC, MIDI, other data sources. If you have other questions specific to this, please let me know. We all have preferences, but there's no definitive tool that is the perfect tool for the job because ideally you're doing something that just allows you to create to the best of your ability. So without further ado, that's me, my rant, and get out there and just start creating things. And don't be afraid to try these softwares. It's just primarily down to preference. So yeah, those are my preferences. All right, thank you.